Hello and welcome to Competent Croshaw's recording hour.
Shut up, they will never know.
They will always know because I will tell them.
Anyway, hello Gabriel.
Hello Yahtzee.
Hello listeners.
Who are hearing this now.
How about that Duke Nukem Forever then?
I don't know. This game's improbable, I tell you. Improbable!
Yes, that was the word you were given.
Yes.
And strangely, you didn't go for the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy text adventure.
Do you really think we could make a video out of a text?
No! Didn't stop some people on the comments mentioning it, though.
Yeah, see, I saw that, and I'm just... I first thought it was like, I appreciate that, but no. I was thinking of doing,
Well, we did do Oregon Trail, and that's mostly text.
That does have... That's still got pictures, though.
Breasts!
Something to look at.
Okay, breasts are gone. Resume.
I was thinking of doing Starship Titanic. But that is...
Yes, I thought you might lean in that direction.
An intensely dull game to watch.
Also, late 90s Windows game.
Yeah, and dialogue heavy. Like, you without hearing what's going on.
It really is. It had this weird sort of dialogue system, as I recall.
You
typed stuff in.
Which didn't work nearly as well as...
I noticed Duke Nukem's indulged in some blackface for this very... This very poorly animated, probably very quickly slapped together intro cinematic.
Dark Nukem kills racism. So yes, the word I had was improbable, and whenever improbable and game come into my mind, invariably I get Duke Nukem Forever.
Yes,
because
we assumed for a while that they just weren't going to bring it out, were they?
Well, the game was improbable in 2002, and then it became fucking impossible. Which
I remember when we thought Daikatana took a long time, 3 years. Jesus, how naive were we?
I know, it's insane when you said, like, Daikatana, oh, that fucking development for fucking ever, 3 years. Nope.
Yes.
So this game was improbable. It was impossible. You did a funny video about how it was impossible.
Yeah, I did a video
and I don't think,
when 3D Realms went down, and I assumed we'd never see the game.
And I don't think anyone can really blame you. It's not like you jumped the gun on that assumption.
I made a hilarious video in which I...
fucking riot.
In which I made up some bollocks about a game... that I would think would actually have taken 14 years to make.
There was ear wiggling.
Yeah.
Controllable ears.
And then they sort of completely undermined that hilarious gag by actually bringing out a game, and it was...
You've been mailing white powder to Randy Pitchford ever since.
You know what? I don't even think this was an awful, awful game. I think this is just kind of mediocre at best. And that's almost the worst possible result.
Well, honestly, if...
I mean, maybe it wouldn't have been so bad if it wasn't so pleased with itself.
I think if it didn't play itself so straight.
Oh, Starners, we mean to go on. Pissing without holding our willy with our hands, because we're a disgusting creature who obviously doesn't care for the state of our trousers.
I remember taking a pee while I was at work when I was bouncing and just walking in and seeing a dude just peeing freehand, and he seemed so proud of himself.
Did he have his hands behind his head? Because that's what I'd do.
No, behind his back, and he was like just full, almost humping the urinal, like there was almost contact.
You know, I'm picturing it now. I'm picturing it with, and he's whistling.
He wasn't whistling, he was too busy grinning.
How much piss have you got in you, Duke, for fuck's sake?
Yeah, I think that's a prostate issue, Duke. Duke Nukem should be the mascot for prostate checks.
And now, we kind of need one.
Yeah. Get it fucking done. I gotta go in for that sooner or later.
You know, I was seeing a chart...
Cancer runs in my family.
I saw
like
a chart once for amount of money raised for specific cause of death versus amount of people who actually die from that cause of death.
Mm.
And way, way at the top of amount raised is breast cancer. And the actual... like a number of deaths from breast cancer was like down at number 12, I think.
Just 12.
Number one was like heart disease for deaths. And you're writing gay, as you would. No, you're writing Gabe. Of course you are.
Helmet.
You signed your name. You just got out of primary school level. Yeah. Well done.
This is me trying to do shit with a mouse. I fucking can't write with a mouse.
Oh, you remembered our anniversary.
Friendship. Except I can't really do a Zed.
Yart Squared? Who the fuck is Yart Squared? Do I know him?
That's somebody who uses your little imp as a picture on Twitter, I'm guessing.
Well, why don't you go and make some videos with Yart Squared then?
Yart Squared Croshaw.
You bitch.
Cheating. I'm cheating on you with other internet famous people.
I'll go see if Blabley Ulshmorton is busy.
That guy's a jerk.
So we're looking at a dramatization of the last level of Duke Nukem 3D.
Which was, if you went into the last level of Duke Nukem 3D with the jetpack and a full Devastator, it was ridiculously
Every
easy.
Every boss fight was ridiculously easy with a full Devastator in Duke Nukem Forever, not Duke Nukem 3D. I don't know why they gave you that thing.
Simplifier. I never used it because I was like, okay, I'm going to need this for something really, really large.
For the
large.
Boss fight, yeah. And you just use it on the boss fight and it's dead in 2 seconds.
Yeah. What is it? Just fucking infinite rockets? It's just a fucking chain gun of rockets.
I know an interesting fact about Duke Nukem 3D, the boss monsters.
Tell us.
Because I used to mess around with Duke Nukem Build. For some reason, the final boss enemy was programmed to only be able to move when he was on top of a specific kind of grass texture.
Huh.
As the one in the field. If you made like a custom level with a concrete floor and put him on, he wouldn't be able to move from his spot.
You could kind of make an interesting kind of thing there with him having sort of a bunch of concrete and then little grass tracks for him to scoot about on.
Is that
what you did?
No. Oh. The AI is not that sophisticated, I think.
Oh.
It's not like to do like pathfinding and shit.
Alright. I don't understand how computer people do your things.
I think it was because they didn't want the boss monster to step onto the border around the green field where the cheerleaders were. Because God forbid Duke Nukem would depict violence being depicted against women. Who would want that in their kooky, slightly ironic 80s, 90s action hero game?
The thing that makes it for me is that disconnect between how ironic the game is and how seriously, like, it sort of takes itself at the same time. Like, who's the guy
It's. I don't think it's self-aware.
That's the creepy thing.
It tries to do comedy without being self-aware.
Yeah, and it straddles that line where it's like, I think it's making fun of itself?
So well,
who's
remember,
the name of the guy? Because you were meant to do it.
Yeah, well, I wasn't meant to do it. I was approached... Yeah.
In my head,
I was approached to write an audition script.
Yeah.
What did you go and stand
okay,
next to that?
Okay, the ammo drop just didn't trigger.
Right.
So I'm just like, all right, I'm going to run up and try and just smack him in the toes.
Yes, I was approached some way into development. I think a new producer was brought on, and he said he wanted to get me on to write a story. And I wrote an audition piece based around, you know, satire and Duke Nukem being the target of the humor. And George Broussard sort of, like, vetoed it because he wanted Duke to be a serious guy, but for the world around him to have funny things in it. And that didn't make a whole lot of sense to me, because the character is basically a dinosaur. He's obsolete.
Well,
he embodies a culture that no longer exists.
Well, it was a culture that barely existed. I mean, a lot of the best action films with, you know, like things like Die Hard, John McClane's not an invincible... You know, superhuman in that. That's what makes the film amazing.
John McClane was almost like what started changing things, I think.
Yeah.
Before, I mean, the kind of thing I'm talking about is the sort of character usually portrayed by Steven Seagal. Just sort of completely unironic, he's the best at everything, like action hero man. Or you're like a Snake Plissken or whatever.
Well, I never, you know, because I grew up watching like Jackie Chan and stuff like that, and in all of Jackie Chan's movies, most of the film is him getting his ass handed to him and him kind of just scraping through.
Yeah.
And it's a little like Indiana Jones, you know, like he gets through on a combination of a little bit of wit, but also a lot of dumb luck. And that's appealing, you know.
Well, for a modern example, I'd say Riddick. Is a very boring character for being just completely unironically without flaws. Yeah.
Honestly, I haven't seen the second one, but the first Tomb Raider movie.
Right.
It was just like, oh, a robot's broken through the wall and is attacking me. Tuesdays.
Yeah, she's the best.
No sense of like sort of.
Yeah,
oh,
there's no
shit.
Sense that they're exerting themselves, I guess. I mean,
and
that's
again,
the problem.
Like, you know, you're watching Jackie Chan do all this amazing shit, but he's also like clutching his shins after kicking another guy and sort of looking frightened, and he's just as surprised that he survived as you are.
Yeah, there has to be a point where at the lowest point.
Yeah.
And virtually every superhero film, like there's the midpoint where they use their superpowers and all the power fantasy shit's going on. Then at the end, there has to be something that sort of negates their powers, like someone who's equally strong.
Or
something else.
Sadness.
Yeah, well, like they have to learn to get by without their powers for a bit.
Hmm. What really makes them important is inside.
Yes, that's why I never really liked Riddick as a character. It was just sort of based on 13-year-old boy's idea of, ooh, this is awesome.
Which is that it's so empty, too. Like, I find that this game could really be easily like if you approach it in a different way, like just everything is given to Duke. There's busts of him everywhere. It's like depressing. It's almost like some kind of horrible form of ego hell.
Yeah, I mean, and if those two girls were sucking him off, they were really far apart. I must say, he must have a sack worthy of Buster Gonad. They're two beach balls glued together.
His dick's 3 inches long but 10 inches wide.
Yeah, they
kind of looks like an old VCR.
They call him the dumbbell.
Oh, what is it?
And
I don't want to touch it.
Here we see Duke Nukem conducting ambassadorial talks with the diplomats from the Uncanny Valley, who've come to
look into our eyes.
Come to his throne room to discuss things.
But I mean, this, you know, everyone just fawns over him. Everyone just, it is perpetual and insane. And
yeah,
like, this would be hell. This would be fucking hell. There's no,
yeah,
there's nothing.
I mean, they sort of have a plot going through this game where the sort of president sort of blames Duke for starting it.
But then everyone around Duke goes, that president's an idiot.
Yeah.
So it kind of just completely,
I mean, it would be kind of cool if Duke did deliberately start it because his life is meaningless without challenge.
It's just, I'm sad. I mean, honestly, what interest could a two-girl blowjob have after, like, the millionth one?
Exactly.
Really, I mean,
you'd never be able to go back, would you?
Yeah, at this point, realistically, he'd be getting into, like, eyes wide shut grade strange shit. Like, it'd be, like, you wouldn't even be touching his penis anymore to be that far in, like.
Yeah, he probably needs to go at it with a cheese grater to get
just
off.
Just hiring toddlers to lick his eyeballs and
he's
that's
just
it.
Sitting
that's
there
just
on his couch.
Now.
Completely stone-faced, pale as the driven snow, as 17 beautiful young Nepalese boys work at him with cheese graters and machetes.
That was years ago.
Because that's the only way he can get any feeling through his calloused bell end.
Now it's just, you know.
Oh, did you at any point in this video jump in front of a mirror?
I can't remember, probably not.
Because that's fucking hilarious, as I recall, because his entire upper body remains ramrod stiff.
Just creepily. This is just me fiddling around with the environment, which was a big part of Duke Nukem 3D.
Well, this is one of the few things I liked about this game, is the whole ego meter thing.
Yeah.
Which is, the ego is your health bar.
Meaningful reward for dicking with Ian.
And when you mess around
I
with
love
the
way he says shit, though.
You mess around with the environment, you get ego points. Mm. And that was always a big part of Duke Nukem 3D. Because it was part of a sort of wave of shooters where they were trying to come up with gameplay beyond shoot the mans.
Yeah, well, it was when they could actually start filling out the the file
size
they
wanted
with
to make,
some extra bits and pieces.
Yeah, trying to make the environments a bit more interactable, add a bit more meaning to the first-person viewpoint.
Mm. Just got 3 in a row. Mm, yeah.
Don't have time to play with myself. That sort of thing.
Except I do, and it's fun. I'm like a 5-year-old at a pool table.
Because now I just get Call of Duty where it's just press F to pay respects the whole time.
God, that is just poetry to me, that sentence.
So, are you winning?
Yeah, this is
so does
called
it boost your ego only if you pot all the balls?
Only if you pot all of them.
But that's not proving anything. You're just swatting them around like a cat.
Yeah, and there's nobody else challenging me. This is, again, it's hollow and it's empty and it's terrifying.
I think this table's, like, tricked. Because look at the way the balls just travel along the cushions.
Yeah, it's designed so I win every time. It's meaningless. It's,
yes. This is your life now, Duke Nukem.
This game should have ended in a suicide.
No challenge.
Nothing matters. There isn't,
except
there's no
whoever cropped that photo of you.
Nothing to overcome.
Just cut off your flap top. Framing on all these pictures just really bugs me for some reason. Rule of three, people.
But that it's not enough for Dookie.
This
not
is
enough.
A rather overlong intro, I thought.
Goes for it. I mean, they did the pop intro of his some action, but yeah, then it just switches off for a long fucking time.
Yeah, there's pacing. And then there's sort of making you wonder where you're going with all
then,
this.
Yeah, then there's having a good long sit-down, which is pretty much what the game does.
Yeah, when I played this game, it was on consoles, and the loading time was fucking awful.
It was. This is on PC, so it was a tad quicker.
Well, I saved a hard drive, I assume.
Yes, the magic of the hard drive. But yeah, so this game was improbable, and then it was impossible, and it's kind of broken me a bit, because the other night I was playing, just goofing around playing fighting games with friends, and one of them just sort of sighed and gone, you know, I would like to see a fucking Shenmue 3 one day. And the first words out of my mouth were, never gonna happen. And then I had to go, oh, Maybe. Because that's what this game is now. Now everything is maybe.
But would you really want to see a Shenmue 3?
Honestly.
Would it ever live up to the expectation?
Well, I mean, yeah, because a Shenmue 3 hasn't been in development. I think that's an important thing. Like, if someone just said, oh, we're going to finally do a Shenmue 3, I'd be like, oh, that's cool.
That's either a massive can or Duke Nukem has a tiny little shriveled hand.
That guy's been standing at that vending machine for ages, and I just took his snack and ate it in front of him. Duke Nukem!
Must have been all that jerking off his calloused bell end.
It probably does
his
have
hands are
too.
Withered.
Looks like Baron Harkonnen in the Dune movie.
I think at this point in the game, Duke Nukem should have been fat.
Yeah.
He should have been fat and getting old.
There's a million ways the narrative.
Prime.
Yeah. There's a million ways the narrative could have been a lot of fun.
And having to pay young imitators of the Olsen twins to come in and mouth his giant balls, overinflated through years of steroid abuse.
Kind of crazy new steroids.
And all the women only want him for his money. Like, he's just gotten out of his 15th bitter divorce.
Yeah.
And then
that
like...
That is an ugly child.
It really is. Now, this is... I did quite like how the name of his book... It's the same as it was in the intro of Duke Nukem 2, because I remember in the intro of Duke Nukem 2, I thought that was quite a funny joke.
Why I'm so great.
That indicates a level of self-awareness that this game lacks.
You see what I mean, though, about just everything is, you know, it just everyone... It is that insanely juvenile idea of being loved, where it's just, you're the best at everything always forever.
Yeah, this is like... paradise for someone who hasn't thought about it.
Yeah, paradise for someone who's never had the joy of... overcoming. Like, that's, you know, this is the fucking part. The idea of... These are the people who actually play through, like, GTA on, like, God mode and don't do it without that sort of thing. Like,
why would you play through a game on God mode?
I don't know. People do, though.
There's no fun.
Or, like, people who buy the full unlocks for video games.
Or use the warp whistle in Mario 3, as we've discussed. Yes.
Yeah. Just, I'm gonna... Here's a fun thing. I'm gonna skip most of it just to get to the little bit at the end that says you're good.
Duke Nukem keeps a green highlighter pen in his utility belt in case he needs to sniff it at some point.
This was me, okay.
To get through the day.
The first button I pushed after I wrote fag with exclamation point, because I figured that's the kind of thing that Duke would write to a child.
Of course.
Was the E button, which is the function button, like, you know, open door, do all this. Nothing happened. So then I went apeshit and started pushing every fucking button. Then I went on the internet and it said push E, and I'm like, okay. And apparently there's this little fucking window early on after you've written something where it won't let you go away from it. So if you push E then, nothing happens.
You hadn't signed it for long enough.
Yeah, I hadn't validated the child. You have to validate the child. It is important.
Well,
I don't think you should have gotten an ego boost for that, considering it's unavoidable.
You don't want to stifle a...
Ugly little thing.
Well, if it was supposed to introduce the concept of getting your ego higher by messing with random things, it sort of makes sense to me.
Oh, yeah, I suppose. I already knew about it, so I monkeyed with the pool table.
So the nothing continues to happen. Oh, but it was an interesting week here in Brisbane, wasn't it?
A thing happened.
A thing happened. Amazing.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've read it in the grown-up news, but there was a rather sudden, unexpected storm blew through the city a couple of days ago.
It was like the ice dog dragged its butt across the city. The crazy thing is it just went so quickly.
Yeah, I've seen some crazy weather in my time in this country, but this takes the... golf ball-sized biscuit.
Dude, the second the fucking cold snap came through, I'm like, it's gonna fucking hail. And then it started hailing, and I was already...
I could hear it coming. I mean, I was already shutting my windows because the rain was coming down hard. And then I heard a roar in the distance. It was like, you know, a stock Arctic roar wind sound effect.
What the fuck is that?
And then things just started smashing against the windows. And as we speak... We've sitting next to...
A plastic bag window.
A plastic bag taped over a massive hole in one of my living room windows. I was in a right tizzy. I was running back and forth from room to room, putting cardboard in front of the windows as they smashed.
Going,
I got amazingly lucky, actually, because this window in this room that smashed, it showered glass all over where I'd been sitting until minutes earlier.
Yeah.
And... each time a window smashed, I happened to be in the other room, making sure the previous broken window was covered up with something.
Because it was one of those storms that every time it kicked up a notch, you were just like, alright, this has got to be the end of it. The hail was coming in sideways. Like, I opened the door...
It was almost like the water was just coming out solidly at that point.
I opened up the door and stuck my head out because, you know, just to get a better look because I was, you know, curious. And I have an awning, so the hail's hitting the awning. I think I'll be okay. I stick my head out and hail hits me in the side of the goddamn head. And then I step back and go, ow! And then hail's coming into the house. It's just hitting the door and then bouncing in. I'm like, all right,
fuck
this.
That explains so much. Explains why you showed up here drooling out of both sides of your mouth.
I saw a guy out in it. That's the best part. Like,
yeah, quite. It was like a rush hour. Yeah. Quite a lot of people were out in it.
But I mean, like, there was no cover. I think it was from like one of the halfway houses down the road, and he's just walking up the street with his hand over his head, and I'm like, that has got to be like just the sky is just paintballs being shot at you, because that I've been caught in hailstorms before. It fucking sucks.
There was no escape.
No, it's just getting horribly pelted. And so, yeah, glaziers are having a fun time this week.
Well, this is the advantage of renting, I suppose.
Yeah.
I've taped plastic over it, now it's the building manager's problem.
Yeah. And I got a call from the real estate, and they're just like, anything broken? And it's like, surprisingly, no, because we're quite close to two larger buildings.
Your place is shitty. Well, my building's like on the top of a hill, and my wall is, with all the windows on, is south-facing, where all the hailstones were being blown into. So quite a lot of windows were smashed in my building.
Fucking nuts, man. Like, Brunswick Street looks like there was a, you know, fucking Old West shootout. Sort of going up and down the street.
But it really puts things in perspective, doesn't it?
Nope.
What if I hadn't gotten another book published before I'd been killed by flying glass?
You'd have been okay.
As it was the instruction to seize the day.
Yeah. You're just there looking at your broken window going, my God, I must make use of this time I've been gifted.
There were little flakes of broken glass all over my apartment. For
just
ages.
Like how Seth MacFarlane slept through his 9/11 flight.
There was always more. I was finding them with the soles of my feet and my back all over my couch.
You should let your room bar up on the couch a little more often.
Can't let pets up on the furniture. Oh, my back's itching. I'll just scratch that. Oh, my hands come away bloody. Oh, you naughty glass shards. You got me, caught me again.
Oh, raspberries.
So, yeah, that was my week.
How was Brisbane?
I was trying to play Dragon Age, and then that happened.
How's Dragon Age? Inquisition-y?
Bloody arduous. But we'll leave that for the review.
Yeah, that's your money. We can't take that away.
What have you been playing, Gabriella?
I'll be on Nukem. I've played through South Park Stick of Truth.
Oh, yes. I reviewed that ages ago, so that is safe territory, although I may repeat jokes.
Credit where it's due, I think. Like, I haven't really sort of watched South Park in, like, 6 or 7 years.
No, me neither. It just kind of stopped. Like how I stopped watching The Simpsons.
Yeah, it just went away.
It didn't. It's never going to be sort of remembered in the Police Squad vein of only having 12 episodes and then stopping. So they'll be remembered as a little gold nugget forever.
It kept going, but I mean the first few series of South Park, like the first series of South Park came out when I was 15, and that hit at exactly the point it needed to, because that was back when that shit was still edgy.
Where's the new edgy comedy today? Something to fly in the face of the new leftism on the internet. That's what I want to know.
It is the rest of the fucking internet. I mean, it's out there. There's weird shit. I mean, stuff I don't necessarily find incredibly funny. Like, I don't laugh at Tim and Eric, but at the same time, I kind of, like, respect what they do.
I have never watched that.
Well, they've done a bunch of things. Again, like, I have kind of a weird relationship with it. Well, like, I get why people find it funny, but I just look at it and go, eh.
Well, as long as you get why other people find it funny, as long as you give your approval, Your Majesty.
Yes, that's exactly that. I can't remember what I was going to say.
Oh my goodness, ow. An alien smacking you in the face.
Yeah, I thought I was able to punch him, and then
that certainly wounds the ego.
Fucking punch!
Nice.
There is a decent sense of impact when you whack the bad guys in this.
If you say so.
Yeah, that's right. South Park Stick of Truth, which is the most accurate adaptation of a property I've ever seen.
You know,
in my entire
life. Dispute referring to that game as an adaptation.
Well, that's what it's
because it was made by the original creators. It's more a continuation of it than an adaptation of
it. Well, it's an adaptation because it's a different medium. Like I kind of read adaptation
as, you know, an adaptation, like adapting something that someone else made.
Well, I think that, that, you know, that's also, you know, can be used in that sense. But I think if it moves from one medium to another,
I wouldn't say like moving from one medium to another is an adaptation, strictly speaking.
Well, it's an adaptation of a TV show into a video game,
I guess, in that sense.
Yeah. Well, that's, I mean, it is exactly what it's, you know, it's South Park to an insane degree. There's no reduction. Like, the graphics are the exact show.
Yeah.
Sound, music, story.
Yeah, it's written by the same guys.
Fucking god damn it!
And because it's a video game now, it sort of adopts sort of a parody of video game tropes.
Yeah.
Well, that South Park parodied other things.
The show's already done, you know, kind of elements of what's in the video game, like the kids playing D&D and stuff like that.
Yeah,
so it builds itself and builds elements and themes from the show into gameplay mechanics quite well.
Apparently there was someone whose entire job was to make this pinball machine, like, work as an actual pinball machine.
It's really? Because it's not that great.
Well, what else are you going to spend 14 years of development time on, I suppose?
Yeah. Because I've played fake pinball machines before, and this is not even in my top 10.
Hmm. I wonder how fulfilled that person felt at the end of the dev cycle.
Have you guys played Duke Nukem's Pinball Simulator? It's so much fun. I don't know about the rest of the game.
Like, he's in a bar with the geek ladies, saying, yes, I actually work in video games. Oh, really? What did you make? Well, I worked on Duke Nukem. Really? That's a really big property. Oh, well, when I say I worked on Duke Nukem, I worked on one specific point of that. Would you happen to remember the pinball machine? No.
Immediate wetness.
Shrunk. Immediate wetness in the sense that they burst into tears.
And then I spend about 10 minutes looking around for the other weight.
Why are you only bicep curling your right arm? Is that because your left arm is your wanking arm and needs no further work?
Needs nothing else. Absolutely nothing else. Otherwise, you get too strong, and then you might accidentally crush your penis when you jerk off.
Have you increased your ego enough yet?
Nope. Still got to do the... It's lopsided, so I take one off, and then I'm like, oh yeah, you got
to
have all the weights on.
No, you need to have maximum weight.
Because you're Duke Nukem. Because
nothing is... Nothing less is sufficient.
Have to be the winner at everything. So lonely.
Just let it go, Duke Nukem.
Oh, that's right, the other weight's over there. Hmm. And then I forget where I threw the first one, so I just punch a guy.
Meanwhile, aliens are invading.
Yeah, but dude, I gotta get my pump.
Of course.
Gotta prioritize.
Gotta make sure
your
biceps are sufficiently swole.
Too swole to control!
Shake out these guns, and also these ones, on the end of the guns.
Got peaks on top of peaks. Actually, now that I think about it, and you're not going to get this, but Duke Nukem is incredibly like Scott Steiner.
Oh, that was it. Maybe he just wasn't quite strong enough to tear that thing off the wall, but now he is. That was the puzzle.
Got
to
eat my spinach as well.
Da-da-da-da-da-da.
Popeye, the clearly drug-addicted man.
Now, what would be Duke Nukem's equivalent of the food that makes the Popeye's theme tune song play when he eats?
Just fucking steroids. Yeah, it's in the game.
Weight gain powder. Like, he
protein
squeezes,
supplement.
Squeezes the weight gain powder tin and the foil top pops off. And he throws it down his gob going, om, rom, rom, rom.
Considering he gets this drunk off one beer. It's a complete fucking lightweight.
What is the food that you imagine hearing the Popeye theme tune when you eat it?
Kangaroo meat. What about yours?
Booze.
You should drink more drinks.
It's the moment when I down the final sip of rum on the rocks. That's not the Popeye the theme tune. Popeye the Sailor Man theme tune.
That's what it played.
That's the hornpipe. Popeye is da 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 da. Pow. That's usually the point where he pounds something with his massive fist. Yeah. Or
Olive when she wasn't shutting up.
Well, what was the name of those, like, that tribe of weirdos he hung around with?
I don't know.
I think they were the goons. But that name has taken on many other meanings since then.
You and your forums.
No, you were singing the hornpipe. one that goes, do your balls hang low? Can you swing them to and fro? Can you tie them in a knot? Can you tie them in a bow? Do you get a funny feeling when you're swinging from the ceiling? Or you'll never be a sailor if your balls hang low.
I love that you know those old, like, bawdy tunes.
Yeah. Hitler, furthermore, has only got one ball.
The only one I can vaguely remember is the Raja of Astrakhan, but that song goes for like 20 fucking minutes. My dad has a book of them, and so many of them are insanely long.
The girls in France pull their knickers down to dance. Yes, the bawdy army songs. An underappreciated subgenre.
You should write some. Do an entire zero punctuation as well.
No.
Yes, I say so.
So now
fans
you're
demand it.
Now you're throwing things at ragdolls.
Yep. I'm Donkey Konging that shit. That was a good one, though. Like, it kind of, like, whacked him in the chest.
I like the way he brings his fists up again every time he throws something. Hooah! Yes!
Must defend the brain.
Fists again. Oh, physics puzzle. Or not.
Not really.
See, if this was Half-Life 2, you just have to stack a load of objects on the other end of the seesaw. We ain't got time for that. No. We have to punch some alien scumbags.
Yeah, they can't see me because I turned the lights off, so I can just sneak up on them. They're like, what's punching me? Oh,
those alien bastards gonna pay for shooting up my ride.
Except, you know, I think in this one my ride is my feet.
I'm sure you have a ride at some point.
Yeah, the little remote control car.
Oh, that's right. That is kind of dumb.
I kind of liked it.
I don't
It was dumb, but it was, I don't know, not offensive to me in any way.
I don't really like first-person shooters that just put driving sections in. I mean, if it's like combat driving, maybe. But if it's just racing driving...
Well, you know, he was shrunk, so kind of...
Well, there's a straight driving section later on.
Yeah, that's right, I forgot about that bit.
Well, yeah, constantly have to find more fuel.
That's not fun.
So how far through the game do you play, anyway?
Not terribly far. I mean, I only played for like an hour and 10 minutes, and...
That's the usual amount of time we do these.
Yeah.
Well done.
And with how long that fucking intro is, you don't actually get very far through the goddamn game.
No, we've only just started shooting aliens. The first shittiest kind of aliens.
Yep.
With the earliest, shittiest guns. An hour in.
Yeah, actually, half a goddamn hour to get to main gameplay. I did like this little puzzle.
Oh, yeah. It's kind of reminded me of puzzles from the original Shadow Warrior. Do you remember that? I had to use a little remote control car to get into
the original a little bit at a friend's house, and...
Well, there was a puzzle like that.
I quite liked the modern version.
I need to get around to playing through that at some point.
It's interesting, because it goes for a lot longer. It's actually quite a long game. And after probably about the first three stages, I was like, eh... But then it kind of really picked up, and it kind of got a,
Is it as mind-bogglingly racist and misogynistic as the original?
I think probably...
I mean, I know...
With a wink and a nod.
I mean, I've made the point before that the word misogyny gets thrown around a bit too easily these days. But Shadow Warrior really does seem to have something in for them. You just run into naked anime girls, and then you use them once, and they start shooting you. And then they start shooting, and you shoot them back, and they
fascinating
explode.
Fascinating window into that human's mind. There are kind of semi-naked anime girls, but it's sort of just a reference to the old one, because...
Yes, I did play that far in
I don't know,
Shadow
I wouldn't...
Warrior.
I don't think there's really any... I didn't even notice any women in it that were...
Well, that's also misogyny. No women equals misogyny. Das Boot, most misogynist film in the world.
You're not allowed to have an opinion on this yet.
You fucked up!
No, you just click a button and magic happens.
Yes, because that is how physics works.
Yeah, because you can manipulate objects. Duke has limited telepathy. Only remote control car telekinesis.
Do you ever watch Robot Wars?
Yes.
I remember in the earlier seasons of that, most robots, if you flip them onto their back, they were fucked.
Mm.
But then one robot had the idea of making its entire front portion like a flipping device, which could be used against enemies.
Didn't that thing,
but
like,
when it
fucking...
was when it was flipped onto its back, it was just able to use it and flip onto its front. And then that became almost standard practice. It was referred to as a SREMEC, or self-righting mechanism.
Well, didn't it, if memory serves, it was kind of like a weird, flat, limpety silver kind of robot, wasn't it?
There were a few that...
Because I remember there was one
that
just dominated for ages. because it was just simple. It was like a flat ramp, and it would just scoot straight into other things and go, whomp, and just knock them over.
Yeah, the wedge shape was very popular.
Yeah. It was kind of a bummer, because I like the complex ones. I mean...
So did you get the British Robot Wars or someone else's Robot Wars?
It's Australia. We got British Robot Wars.
Of course.
Fantastic.
I think Duke Nukem's masturbating outside.
Gotta get it close to the chainsaw.
Some kind of maintenance is being undertaken. You'd almost think a large number of windows were smashed recently in this building.
It's a flock of angry bees.
Oh yeah, it's the steroids. This is what happened to your balls, Duke Nukem. I mean, they're both 6 foot across, but they will never feel sensation again. I hope you feel fulfilled.
Okay, we found a new formula of steroid that doesn't shrink the testicles.
They are turning blue as we speak, but they won't get any smaller. You will now have to eat the equivalent diet of 7 men to not die.
A little bit like the Flash, but with enormous testicles, so, you know. Enormous fucking balls.
And you just eat every shot, fuck cover.
Ego. The ego protects, the ego defends all.
Well, in the original Duke Nukem 3D, they just put health items fucking everywhere to compensate.
Yeah. I like the kind of funny little puppet strings cut when they die. Like,
yeah, those are some big fucking big cans. I think people who have to crush the can when they finish drinking are just very insecure.
Unless you do it against your head, and that's badass.
Well, that's like twice as insecure. That's both insecure and frustrated at the world.
Or Sandman, if...
Not getting enough. Apparently there's some thing that apparently if you fiddle with the label of an empty beer bottle, it means you're sexually frustrated. And I do remember...
From the pages of pop psychology.
I do remember doing that a lot back before I had a girlfriend.
Back when you were incredibly sexually frustrated.
Yes.
I remember the good old days of incredibly sexually frustrated Yahtzee.
I'm mellow these days.
Practically a changed man.
Now I can talk freely about how much I hate women.
Without it being triple creepy.
Exactly.
Before it was horrifying.
I hate women and long for them to pay me the even slightest bit of attention.
Yahtzee Kershaw, not misogynist.
Well, quite. I'm a miso-lovely gymnast. Lovely gymnasts.
I hate you, why don't you love me?
I'm a gynophile. That sounds horrible, even worse somehow.
Dig up, stupid!
I was having a conversation this morning about, there is a fetish for everything.
Yep.
Then I made the point, the one thing that there isn't a fetish for is... not being aroused. I mean, if you had a fetish for not being aroused, that would destroy the universe.
I don't know, I read about paraphilia. Sometimes they are sort of stimulatory but non-sexual. Like, there are people who get an incredibly intense sensation from listening to, like, very, like, whispering and, like, boxes sliding in and out of each other.
Well, you're probably overthinking it at this point. I was just like, someone would be like, oh, I'm completely not in the mood. Oh, God, that makes me hot. Oh, wait.
Ah, God damn it. It's over so quickly.
And now for the standard issue, first-person shooter turret fight. I mean, if they did it as a joke, but this is just a straight turret fight.
That's the thing, like, I mean, everything in this is a joke if you kind of work and make it one.
I mean, if he was on the turret for a bit and then went, oh, bollocks to this, and then, like, yanked it off the tripod and then got to jump around on floating platforms and shit, that might have like, been tolerable.
So many ways, it could have been fun.
But no, just straight turret fight.
You know, it's almost like this was false advertising.
They do... sort of do that thing in later parts of the game. I seem to remember them making a joke about key card locks, where they go, fuck key cards.
I think I actually come across that at some point.
Although they do have, like, key card stand-in puzzles, where you just have to find the power cell to continue.
Yeah.
Or find the can of fuel to
open a door.
Continue, which is following the letter rather than the spirit of the law, I think.
Door's closed, open door. Okay, I have to get the thing. Speaking of misleading advertising.
I remember this being very annoying.
It's just not interesting. It's not annoying to me, it's just very dull.
Yes, we've got another news story from the week. Sony has been charged by an advertising standards authority with misleading advertising with the PlayStation Vita.
Which is interesting.
And now everyone who bought a PS Vita before June 2012 is entitled to either a $25 cash settlement or a $50 voucher for PlayStation products. Quids in, guys! Get it while it's hot!
How much do you suppose it's going to add up to?
I don't know, I think Sony are banking on most people not bothering.
Can the $50 gift certificate be used on things that aren't the Vita?
Well, I think it's like a Sony gift certificate, so you can buy like Sony products with it.
Well, I mean, you know, on PSN that'd be.
Why would you want to buy Sony products after they've betrayed you once already?
You betrayed my feelings. Yeah, it's kind of.
I'm going to take the $25.
This sets a really interesting precedent because the article we read on Escapist said that. I mean, you. What were the three things?
Memory challenge.
All right. Well, firstly, they claimed
that you could start a game on the PS3, and then if you had to move, you could continue. You could pick up where you left off on the Vita.
Which it couldn't really.
But it turned out there was only a small number of games that you could do that, and also you had to buy the game twice. Once for the PS3 and once for the Vita.
Fucking insane.
They were also made misleading claims about online multiplayer.
Well, that's the bit that interests me most, because the Escapist article said that the PlayStation advertising heavily implied that if you bought the 4G connected PS Vita, you'd get full online multiplayer. When in reality, it really only worked with asymmetrical or turn-based.
Well, that
games.
Is technically still online multiplayer.
I know, but that's the interesting thing. Like, normally with, you know, false advertising, you have to say something directly and have it directly not be true, because otherwise there's wiggle room.
Well,
I'm just interested. I'm probably going to have to go read the thing myself, because I need to know now.
There's a lot of laws around this sort of thing based on what, you know. Like, what the average idiot, I think. I think QI did an episode once where they talked about legal terms such as moron in a hurry. Like, if a moron in a hurry would mistake your product for someone else's product, then that's sort of breaking
and
copyright.
This is where we get our laws and structures from. But I mean, it's...
Like, if you sold a product in a red can called Stoker-Zola, a moron in a hurry would probably be fooled.
This was a Coke...
But, that's why in some cases, two different products can use the same name, like the Volkswagen Polo. No one buys that assuming that they're buying the Mint.
Yeah. I mean, because wasn't there some kind of thing against Colonial Marines for the difference between demonstrated gameplay and actual gameplay? Because I'm curious as to how far this could be taken.
I'm not sure what the legal result of that was. But it's good to see it happening, because these days, exaggerating in the advertising seems to be standard practice.
Oh, for the goddamn course. I mean, the graphic difference between, Watch Dogs as advertised and Watch Dogs in action.
It is very Weasley. Mm. Especially when they, create what they show us what they claim to be a gameplay trailer, which is so obviously scripted.
Cluster of lies!
Like the one they showed for Assassin's Creed Unity at E3 leaps to mind.
Unity!
Like the player in the video pauses by a door, and it's with perfect timing, an enemy walks next to it and is distracted for a moment, allowing us to run in. And those like four players who were playing co-op in that video were way too coordinated for players who couldn't actually communicate online.
Somehow this is all just working. We're multiple, man. That's the only explanation.
I'm afraid I don't see the appeal in having three other gadabouts fucking about.
While
you're trying to do a stealthy, like, precise assassination.
Yeah, like, if it was a designed from the ground up thing, so it was like, hey, Yahtzee, let's get two friends together and we'll have an organized four-man assassination team.
I don't want to have to organize four guys.
I'm not saying that should be the basis of the game. I'm just saying, if it was that, it'd be better. Having just you playing a game and then someone going, I'm helping, and sort of stroll through, that would just drive me fucking insane.
That's always how I feel playing a co-op game. I feel like the I'm helping guy.
Yeah, and
I just want to play on my own pace, frankly. That's why I don't really like co-op.
Because I was really, really, really bored last night and decided just to play through some fucking bits of Borderlands 2.
You fool!
Well, I downloaded it because my lady friend really likes Borderlands 2, and so it
became a... Ooh, let's double date. Let's braid each other's hair.
So, of course, then I had to download Borderlands 2.
Of course.
And so, you know, I find it's a little bit like Pizza Hut pizza. Same as Dead Island to me. Like, are they good games? I don't really think so. But I can turn them on and just sort of monkey around with them and then go away. So I was playing with that. And then my housemate jumped on and I'm like, get the fuck out of my game or I'll kill
you. The lady killer. Ooh, that's rather unfortunate.
A grim omen of things to come. The legitimate and kind of frightening lady killer. It's not funny.
Oh, I remember this bit. This bit's fucking annoying.
I didn't even know what the fuck I was supposed to be doing, really. I
think that's the usual reaction.
I did this whole sequence without error, and I'm not sure if... I didn't feel like I was having an effect on what was going on.
Yeah, you gotta pull the brake, but not in such a way that it overheats.
Click the mouse occasionally.
Yeah, and meanwhile this lady screams at you, which only makes this even more charming, I think.
So I'm trying to keep an eye on like where we are outside. I'm like, am I slowing it down enough? Because that's the thing, like, how am I supposed to know like what's a lethal fall speed?
Well, yes, quite. I mean, I died like 3 times on this.
I'll tell you one that I died on an embarrassing amount of times. The opening runaway. Oh. Yeah, see? I didn't even know.
There, you hit the bottom. I think you were supposed to be paying attention to the number of the floors you were on.
Oh, but didn't even notice. Stumbled dick first into victory.
You must now suck me off. It is the rule.
Hey!
Oh, never mind. Oh no, you shrunk down.
Yep.
How emasculating.
It's nothing funny.
Now your scrotum is only the size of a regular-sized scrotum. I'm
dragging it along the ground like one of those rats.
Hey, it's that kid with the stupid hair.
I'd like to see a movie where Mickey Rourke plays like an old, depressed Duke Nukem. Mickey Rourke almost is an old, depressed Duke Nukem. He beat up a Russian 29-year-old the other day.
Well, that was just the wrestler, wasn't it?
Yeah, pretty much. He got back in the boxing ring recently and beat up some guy half his age, which is interesting. It takes a lot of fitness to do that, so I suppose he's got that still.
Now you are a tiny Duke driving around. And you know what? This doesn't even make sense in the context of making a cathartic, big macho shooter experience.
That's why I find it interesting. Like,
this is just kind of dumb.
Where do you think this came in? I'd kind of like to see a documentary about this, or just a big timeline of where the gameplay elements came into it, like what happened.
Well, I think shrinking has always been a big part of Duke
Nukem. Oh yeah, I mean it was in 3D.
And I think they wanted to put that in anyway. Mm. And then someone said, hey, let's drive a remote control car around while you're shrunk, why not?
Yeah. Adventure!
Cars.
Duke Nukem. The more I think about it now, the more the fucking Dookie Rourke just makes more sense than it should. Sad facial paralysis, old lunatic.
So, yes. More legal action against evil corporations trying to squeeze money out by lying, please.
I would really like to see a few more brought, you know, in terms of
They almost don't need to lie. There's plenty of weasel techniques to be able to sort of skirt around the truth.
Well, that and there's plenty of games that are just borderline fucking critic-proof. I mean...
Well, quite. Call of Duty,
What's COD gonna do to lose its fucking fan base?
Not let you shoot Arabs.
Well, didn't this most recent one not shoot Arabs?
You do shoot, like, some vaguely foreign types early on.
Oh, well, that doesn't it shift straight into PMCs or something? Because PMCs are the new easy one.
Well, it starts off with you, well, the PMCs being, you know, the heroes, and you being part of them.
Yeah.
And then later on, there's a revelation, and Kevin Spacey turns evil, and...
I kind of want to play it just because I really like Kevin Spacey.
Your fellow PMC soldiers turn against you.
I've been watching,
Kevin Spacey plays one role, and it is smartest guy in the plot.
And slightly evilest guy.
Yes. Well, that almost often goes dead. Hand in glove in today's anti-intellectual arts.
Well, I'm finally catching up on the final, last few episodes of season 2 of House of Cards.
Probably won't be as good as, the original House of Cards, which I have seen. I don't really want to watch the new one, because I really liked the original, and...
Who's in the original?
Ian Richardson. Playing Francis Urquhart, who's, chief whip of the ruling party of the United Kingdom, and later Prime Minister, not whatever the hell Kevin Spacey is.
Vice President.
Right. Probably not the...
I don't know. Kevin Spacey plays a good sort of evil borderline sociopath.
See, that doesn't make a lot of sense to me. I mean, Francis Urquhart in the original House of Cards sort of takes revenge on his own party because he's passed over for promotion. That's... Because he's in a sort of... The chief whip is sort of like the... Like a backroom boy position.
Yeah.
And he's sort of like unhappy about being overlooked for the cabinet.
That's how this one starts as well, but... I mean, he still is a manipulative fucking...
Well, by the end, he's made himself Prime Minister because that's how the British electoral system works.
If you beat a man in Queensbury rules, you become Prime Minister.
I mean, sort of unlike the American presidency, you're not really voting for a person, you're voting for a party, and just whoever happens to be in charge of that party is the Prime Minister. So if the party has internal like leadership changes, that can you can get a different Prime Minister with no say from the public at all.
Mm. Well, the power structure and, you know... The Westminster system's quite different.
Yeah, happened in Australia, didn't it? I mean, Julia Gillard became Prime Minister. I don't think anyone...
Kevin Rudd was Prime Minister, then Julia Gillard was Prime Minister, and then Kevin Rudd was Prime Minister.
But the point is, no one voted in Julia Gillard. It was like an internal...
Julia Gillard did win an election on her own.
Oh, okay.
Kind of by the skin of her teeth.
Right. Well, everyone wanted to say they'd done the Thatcher thing and had a female one. Still waiting for you to catch up there, America. Hillary Clinton, 2016.
America.
Let's see if people will shut up about Benghazi for 5 fucking seconds.
That won't happen. Gotta find a way to raise the kids. Good old America is the gift that keeps on giving.
Yep. Anytime you think politics is a bit depressing in other countries, and that certainly is depressing in Australia right now.
Yeah.
Like, we just look to America and say, we're glad we're not them.
Yeah, Australia's got a lot wrong with it. And then you find, like, you know, you'll stumble across an article that's like, top 10 crazy things elected Republicans have said this week, and you're like,
I mean, you almost sort of feel glad that Tony Abbott is so obviously shit to everyone.
To other right-wing people. Like, yeah, at the moment, Andrew Bolt defended... the ABC. And if you don't, like, that is fucking insane.
Because, Tony Abbott seems to be diligently trying to dismantle the ABC at the moment, because the ABC isn't owned by Murdoch. And the Murdoch papers about the only thing that still support Tony Abbott. And I'm pretty sure that's only because Murdoch gave them some kind of standing instruction to support them, and then Murdoch has now completely lost interest.
Well,
so now it's all just middle managers going, now we must continue King Rupert's doctrine.
Murdoch didn't want the NBN.
Yes.
Because wherever internet and video on demand goes, his Foxtel subscriptions fucking collapse.
So now Murdoch Papers keep talking up Tony Abbott, because that's all they do, just keep following this last directive given.
The shit you have to, like, Andrew Bolt hates the ABC with a venom, and... I mean, if you told me, like, a few weeks ago that was going to happen, I'd have, again, you know, we're entering into the impossible territory. Somehow my gun still takes out aliens in one shot. I didn't even know that. That's just silly to me.
Well, maybe they're just so annoying. Like those tiny glass shards I've been finding with my arse.
My bum! Send your, you know, words of support to Yahtzee's bum on Twitter.
Send word of support to my building manager so he'll get these fucking windows fixed.
Hashtag Yahtzee's bum.
No, Yahtzee's building manager.
Bum.
Building manager.
Bum is short for building manager. It's just BM with a U in the middle.
Okay. Yeah, I guess that works. Because building starts with BU.
Yeah, it's completely, completely acceptable.
Why are they called buildings? They should be called builds, lol.
Ha 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 ha.
This is another thing that goes on way too long.
Yeah, just... And then, it's
over. Fucking Tiny Duke joke.
And we got the rebigulator, so... Yeah, the second you see the little cart destroyed, it's like, good, it's over. And I forget you have to push the little...
Well, you're still gonna be small for a bit.
Oh, no.
Blimey, those bouncy couches are worthy of Sunset Overdrive. Everything was bouncy in that.
Day glow, super fun, happy ride of a game.
Potted bushes were bouncy. You could bounce up 3 stories in the air.
Alright.
And grind across rails despite no apparent means of propulsion.
I'm compelled to go to the questions section. A, because we're 10 minutes off the end. And B, because the top question you have there is, what are your opinions on hip-hop? And I am unaware that you've ever had an opinion on hip-hop.
I had a feeling this would be more a question for you, though. It's a question by Kay Shaw.
Kay Shaw, yeah.
Say, what are your opinions on hip-hop, and who are your favourite hip-hop artists, if you have any?
How about you answer first?
No, you answer first.
I'm just moderately curious. Okay, if you want to... Next time, if you want a question that I'd enjoy answering, pick one of the wrestling ones, because it's probably...
I don't like hip-hop. I'm a classic rock snob.
I know, that's why I'm surprised you've... I mean, yeah, you like your ballads. You like your, you know, your fucking guitar licks and your songs about girls and stuff.
I just... Yeah, I just don't like all that macho posturing in hip-hop. What's your favourite, then?
Oh, God, to have a favourite. Well, you know, I grew up listening to it.
Yes, it means
it
to have
smoking.
One that you like more than all the other ones.
Well, I mean, the immediate thing that comes to mind is Wu-Tang Clan, just because they're great. There's more of them than makes any fucking sense to have for a single...
Well, what a great argument. I'm convinced. They're great.
Well, you know, End of the 36 Chambers is an amazing opening album. It has just shitloads of amazing songs. They're interesting rappers. They don't just sort of... Like, they've got an interesting lyrical layout, and probably one of the things...
Okay, what do they sing about besides bitches, money, and guns?
How they're not to be fucked with.
Okay, that was the other thing.
well, you know, there's songs that are sort of about like,
you know, I say that dismissively, but in retrospect, most songs are about bitches, aren't they?
Yeah, like, to be fair, that's all your power ballads and shit, man. Songs, yeah, like, ah, girls hurt me.
Way too many songs are about the bitches.
Just songs in general are about what I mean, we think about, which is just genitals of whatever sex we're attracted to.
I mean, "Wonderful Tonight" by Clapton is about bitches.
Yeah, I am helping with my shotgun.
Oh no!
But I think one of the things that drew me to
well, they're off. Plan. They'll probably be fine.
Yeah, they're all right.
They won't be off to some hideously jarring shift of tone later on in the game.
Like, Wu-Tang Clan rapped about geeky shit back before there was an entire genre for that, and that was what kind of drew me.
Did they rap
in the first
about
place.
The Princess Zelda?
No. Like, that's the great thing about Wu-Tang Clan. Like, for some reason. The, you know, Sega was really only big in Europe, Australia, and the fucking ghetto. So there's a song called Protoculture by Deltron 3030 where he talks about the Sega Saturn.
Okay.
And that's fucking insane. Like, just for that to be in a not specifically nerdcore hip hop song is fucking fascinating. And like, there's lines in Wu-Tang Clan songs about Voltron and stuff like that, and old kung fu movies that I enjoyed. So it kind of drew me to that when I was much younger. But it's like, hey, these guys are really, like, cool and interesting, but they're also, you know...
What rhymes with Voltron? I'm trying to think of a rap lyric that ends with, like Voltron.
It was kind of like a midway lyric, so I don't think anything was specifically rhymed with
it. Well, why'd they even bring up Voltron, then?
Because they're talking about the way Wu-Tang Clan comes together to form a greater whole.
It's almost cute, really.
Otherwise, I enjoy.
Yeah,
the...
we're as powerful as Voltron.
Yeah. Well, that's you
it's
know,
like 15-year-olds saying, "No one mess with the killer face gang."
Yeah, that's they're, believe me, there's a degree of self awareness to the Wu-Tang Clan.
Well, they're called the Wu-Tang Clan.
Yeah, they're not like fucking unaware of the kind of humor about what they do.
Okay.
Otherwise, I enjoy, like, you know, your sort of everything from your kind of fun stuff, your melodics like J5 and things like that, to your passionate revolutionaries like Immortal Technique.
Do you like your Tupac?
A little. I mean, Tupac was a fucking good rapper. I'd say Big E was probably the better of the two.
Wait. Which, do you mean...
Biggie Smalls.
Was Biggie Smalls the same one as Notorious B.I.G.?
Oh, God, probably. I can't remember.
Because they keep changing...
They have a thousand,
They keep changing it, don't they?
The Onion had a great article that summed this up once, which was, man claims to have traced the entire genealogy of the Wu-Tang Clan, because each member had about 5 different fucking names. It's a weird thing with... Rappers love their fucking different
like
identities.
Snoop Dogg.
Yeah, Snoop Lion now, I think. Or did he change back?
It was Snoop Doggy Dogg at first, wasn't it?
Originally, yeah.
And then he was just Snoop Dogg.
With
Little Bow Wow.
That was not Snoop Dogg.
Oh, sorry, Lil Bow Wow.
That's some kid.
Who needs consonants?
And then there's, you know, sort of old greats like Criss Cross, whose entire gimmick was wearing clothes backwards.
Yes, well, that's enough about hip-hop. I felt too left out.
That was why I looked up. I was, what are your opinions of hip hop? I'm like, does Yahtzee have opinions on hip hop? I was desperate to find out.
Thought I'd throw you a bone, and now I regret it.
Well, next time, make it a wrestling bone. All right,
I don't want to throw you a wrestling bone. Because that sounds dirty.
One I got that was sort of way, way deep in my Twitter thing, so I can't find who sent it to me, and I don't care to look really, was...
Well, that's just charming.
Oh, dude, I'd have to scroll through, like, Twitter feed for, like, the next 5 minutes.
And all right, what's the question?
Just about what you think makes, you know, is there a difference between a casual gamer and kind of more hardcore gamer, and what do you think that difference would be?
Oh, what a boring question.
Well, it's something to fucking talk about.
Well, a casual gamer, and stop me if I'm getting too complex here, is one for someone who plays casual games. And a hardcore gamer is someone who plays hardcore games. Thanks for the question, whatever your stupid name was. Next, please.
You've left some questions on here that we've answered.
Have I?
Yeah.
Well,
we discussed the writer's block thing.
Did we? I don't...
If you had to become an insufferable fan of a specific fandom, which would you choose? By J-Bone DRS. I need to hear your answer on this.
Sort of a weird question, really.
Yeah. Nonetheless.
Do I have to be insufferable with it?
Well, that seems to be... The word insufferable is in the
question. I suppose the question is, what fandom is less shameful to be insufferable about? Drugs! I want to be an insufferable fan about drugs.
Oh, dude, I don't know, man.
Drugs, car engines, and lifting weights. I will be an insufferable fan about those, and then I will not be shunned by society.
That is fucking insufferable.
I could be pretty insufferable about Red Dwarf, if you like.
I don't know, I'd say you're pretty moderate on that. I mean, you will recite entire bits, but...
Season 5 was the best. And if you disagree, then you're wrong. And I loathe you. And you should be killed with a bazookoid. Set to homing.
Yeah.
Why would a mining laser need a homing setting?
I've never thought about that.
Yes. Because they were mining.
You are. Actually, no, there you are. You are insufferable.
They were supposed to be mining lasers because they were a mining ship. Yeah. They weren't kitted out for battle.
And then in the later seasons, they had a prison on them. So fucking mining and prison ship.
We disregard that season.
that's
assume there was season 6, then something weird happened, then maybe season 10, if you like.
It dies at season 6 for me.
Well, I think I mentioned before I watched season 10 and I found it surprisingly tolerable, but a little excruciating at times.
Surprisingly tolerable is not a good thing to say about something that used to be fucking amazing.
Well, I wanted it to...
That was a good shot.
I think that you do get invested in characters if you're familiar with them, even if the work they're in isn't particularly high quality.
Yeah.
It's just nice to see the gang back together.
I might get around to having a look at it one day.
That's why soap operas keep going.
Yeah.
I mean, they're not high quality productions, but they've been going on so long everyone's familiar with the characters and invested in their struggles.
Pretty much.
Mind you, American sitcoms are a whole new dimension of awful compared to the British and Australian ones.
Australia doesn't have a lot of sitcoms of which to speak.
American sitcoms are just sort of chorus lines of incredibly unrealistically muscled men with terrible acting skills.
They're getting better. I mean, it depends on what you mean. I mean, there's things like, you know, Always Sunny in Philadelphia, like stuff like Louis.
I'm talking about shit like Days of Our Lives.
Oh, you mean soaps?
Yeah, that's what I said. Soap operas.
You said sitcoms.
Oh, I said soap operas, didn't I?
You said sitcoms.
I meant soap operas.
Okay, all right. Cool. Right. Because that was fucking confusing. Because, fucking sitcoms and they're weirdly muscular. I'm like, huh?
Yes.
Take this to a weird place.
The things people refer to when they talk about watching grandma's stories.
Yeah. Back when I was still a stoner and back when you could get bored of the internet.
Oh, platforming in first-person shooters. How I missed thee.
I watched probably most of Passions.
Oh, I remember that. That was the one with the really fucking out-of-place supernatural elements, wasn't it?
Yeah, which is what made it funny. And then there was an orangutan after
completely straight-faced. Completely straight-faced. Yeah. Terrible acting. Like, bimbos and himbos. Just talking about mermaids and witches and the devil and
yeah,
shit.
Yeah, and then witches were real.
Well, Passions were sort of a... You know, fixed on the paranormal thing, but sometimes the paranormal would just come into the ostensibly straight ones.
Yeah.
And that was where it got even funnier.
I think Days of Our Lives were probably the most mental for that one.
What was that one where someone just got possessed by the devil for some reason?
How do you suppose that conversation goes in the writer's room?
Well, you compare that, like the American soap opera, which is always like about incredibly attractive rich people having like really fucking stupid adventures. And you compare it to like the British sitcom, like EastEnders, which is just fucking grimy people and their hideous lives.
Horrible.
It's
chavs, I think was that the term for
it. I think that speaks to what we were talking about earlier about how the British sort of like to see people being taken down a peg because of the class system.
Isn't EastEnders people already as down as many pegs as they're gonna get?
I can't remember if we were talking about this on this take or the one that fucked up. We were talking about the British comedic hero. There's always like a social climber being shat on by the world around him.
That was the one that fucked up, because I think that one came from the Leslie Nielsen conversation.
Yes, which you missed, and which was really amazing and probably our A material.
Yep.
Oh well.
Yahtzee hadn't checked his SD card that he uses for the records, and it was full.
Yes. I haven't been that before. That was a new one. We fucked up in a myriad of ways.
Yeah, you're always finding new ways to make sure that the records don't go ahead as to plan.
Luckily, we noticed about 20 minutes in.
Mm. Okay, if I had to be an insufferable fan of a specific fandom...
Well, you already are one of Doctor Who.
Oh, no, dude. If you think I'm insufferable, you haven't seen...
Well, I guess that's a part of that whole Super Hulock triumvirate.
No, I stay the fuck away. Like, I don't talk to other people about Doctor Who. I don't go onto the websites about it. I watch it by myself.
That's probably a good plan.
The fandom fucking...
It attracts the creepy Tumblr fans.
The fandom wrecked it. Almost fucking wrecked it. Like, I used to go to a Doctor Who fan club, like, back in the 90s, because it was fun.
Woo.
I wouldn't go anywhere near that now.
The political correctness mob.
Oh, they're just grotesque.
I'm gonna try...
People who watch a show because they hate it.
Shall we try and end this video before the video runs out? Just as... And so we don't have to, like... I don't have to mess around tacking on an extra bit of video in the edit.
I'd be a horrible Sonic fan.
That would be much... Well, I think you're in a lot of company there.
Oh, man.
I don't think there's any such thing as a non-horrible Sonic fan these days. I mean, what do you expect? The games are so shit. You can't just be a straight fan of it these days.
I would delete my positive memories of Sonic if it eliminated the Sonic fandom from human, like, just canon.
Have you ever played this game? I forget where I heard about this game, but what you do is you go into Google Image Search and you type your first name. The Hedgehog, and then you see what results come up.
Yeah. Here's the great one. You know Cormac, who, like, runs the bar?
Yes.
We looked up Cormac the Hedgehog. There was no Cormac the Hedgehog. There was, however, Cormac Prower. So he didn't even have a hedgehog. He had a two-tailed fox, and it had a backstory.
Was it related to Miles Prower?
Yeah.
Long-lost brother or something?
Yeah, and it had, like, the story about his eyes going furiously red whenever someone was mean to him. Every single one of these things just screams, like, almost like childhood neglect.
Well, it's all, like, it's got to be all, like, 12-year-olds doing this shit.
I fucking hope so,
yeah.
Like, honestly, it is, like...
I mean, otherwise you're getting into Chris Chan territory.
Yeah, the DeviantArt Sonic hole is just heartbreaking. Like, it is just cripplingly heartbreaking.
Yeah, I've looked up Yahtzee the Hedgehog and Ben the Hedgehog. There's something for each.
I read a huge chunk of that Yahtzee and Equestria fucking...
There's your homework, listeners.
Yeah, read the Yahtzee and Equestria. They don't have your dialogue down. I don't think
I don't think it's a challenge to be an insufferable Sonic fan. Be a sufferable Sonic fan. Be a classy Sonic fan. I'd like to see one of those who, like, sits in a high-backed, leather-bound armchair wearing a Hugh Hefner dressing gown.
404 in my brain. There's nothing there
reading,
when you say classy Sonic
reading
fan.
Like a Sonic choose-your-own-adventure book with a brandy glass.
Doesn't exist. It doesn't. Nope.
Probably do.
No, don't believe it. No, here's your classy Sonic fan. It'll be that, except he's in a shitty old armchair in his basement in a fedora going, I'm classy.
Oh, yeah.
That's the classy Sonic fan. It's even worse.
He wears a waistcoat that stinks of old milk.
And, you know, was his granddad's and doesn't fit him.
Shit.
Can't do the buttons.
Shit. 35 seconds left on the video.
Fuck Sonic the Hedgehog. Fuck the fans.
Sing along.
Reevaluate your life. Get off the internet with your Sonic. Penis, penis, masculinity, penis, penis.